Hi everyone, or I mean, good morning. Welcome to this webinar from our Leadership Skills series. Today we'll be talking about decision making for leaders. So my name is Rick Lemarois, and I am a marketing manager here at HeadSpring. This webinar is intended to be interactive. I mean, we want to hear from you. So please do send in your comments, your questions. So there's a question box here on the side. So please just do send them in. We'll answer them at the end. So I mean, today we're joined with, well, sorry, joined by Adam Kingle, who is a leadership and management educator. He's as well an author of the book Next Generation Leadership, and as well he's a strategy consultant. Hi Adam, I'm glad you could join us today.
Hi, thanks for having me.
Yes, thank you.
Pleasure to see you all out in cyberland. So yes, my name's Adam Kingle. I'm an author, advisor, educator. I've just written a book called Next Generation Leadership, which I'm bringing up on my pneumatic raising platform. See, that's what it looks like. It's going down now. And you know what, ladies and gentlemen, I have to apologize for my hair. You know, we reached that stage where I usually have it cut every 5, 6 weeks. It's obviously been 3 months. I can't do anything with it now. You know, it's a lost cause. It's just gonna pop up wherever it's gonna pop. So the decision that I've made is to cut it myself tomorrow night, so at least I have the weekend to recover from whatever gross indecency I inflict on myself. But enough about me. Let's talk about decision making. This is one of the areas that I do find myself talking a lot about, particularly with my clients in the role of a strategy advisor or a marketing strategy advisor. And I tend to talk about it from the human dynamic and the process point of view. In other words, how as leaders do we have to construct the environment, the steps, the questions we have to ask in order to make better strategic decisions? So full disclosure, I'm not a data scientist or a decision-making scientist. I did an MBA, so like many of you probably, where that was part of our core course was decision and risk analysis. So I know some of the tools available as well, but I'm going to talk more about the human aspects of decision making and the leadership aspects of decision making. I will touch on tools with the caveat that a little knowledge can be a dangerous thing. So I'll tell you about how I use them, or more accurately, how I commission others to use them. Let me show you our agenda for today. Let me just reduce that. There we go. Okay, so here's what we're going to talk about. Instinct, art, and science, right? These are all things that intermingle and interplay. The tools, as I mentioned, I'll share some of my favorites with you, if helpful. Then I'll talk about the biases that occur in making decisions, the team dynamics, positive and negative, that occur in making decisions. And then I'll share some great habits, either for you to practice or to encourage in your teams, departments, organizations. By the by, I'm going to pause at 10 to 15 minutes to 11 British time to take questions. So if you do have questions or comments, whatever, you can just pop them in the questions box and we will get to them. And Loic and I will moderate those and answer as many as we can. Similarly, you might be asking, how furiously do I have to scribble notes and sort of take, you know, photos of my slides, etc. If on request, HeadSpring can make my slides available in PDF format, but please ask. So it's on request. So let's get into it. I want to start, as Loic promised, we wanted to make this interactive. So if you're on this webinar, and you must be if you're hearing my voice, I want to know, what is it about this topic of decision making that maybe attracted you to invest an hour of your time today? So there must be something tricky or difficult. You might have a perturbation about decision making that you'd like to ease your soul, your conscience on the topic of decision making. So we're going to run a poll, and it's this question: well, what is it about decision making in your organization that you find difficult? That poll is now open, and you'll see it on your right-hand side. So is it's unclear about when and how to use data? Is it, you know, too many decisions are pushed up the chain of command? So, you know, a tiny amount of people in the C-suite are making the decision, and then we're simply told what the decision is, and maybe not even why or how the decision was made. maybe our decision making is very siloed. So one department makes a decision that affects everyone, you know, but no one else was included. We have inadequate time to make a proper decision. I hear that, you know, quite a lot. Like, we're rushed to make really big decisions here, right? And we spent maybe, you know, all of a 1 hour committee meeting to do it. Or is it something that I haven't thought of? Is it other? Which I know is an all-encompassing term. So I just want to get a sense of where we are in terms of what you find difficult or frustrating. So let's look at our results. So over half of you are saying too many decisions are pushed up the chain of command. I think that's very common. That's typical. And then actually quite small distribution after that, unclear how and when to use data, 10%. Very siloed within a department, 17%. So for many of you, it's like, I'm not involved in the decision making, the strategic decision making, at least in my organization. Well, if you're a senior person or an HR person, you probably have more power over changing that dynamic, that process, than you think. And I hope I can give you some value add so that when your CEO says, okay, you want to do this differently, what do you propose we do? You'll have some good answers for them. Let's talk about this idea of instinct versus art versus science of decision making. Instinct. How much do we use instinct? I think, you know, probably too much, right? Organizations will choose from a number of options, you know, because that feels like the right decision. At the same time, I will admit that instinct is sometimes the name we give to experience. So subconsciously, tacitly, we're using our experience in order to select one option over others, even if we can't objectively say why. Now, I'm not saying that that is always the way to go, but instinct is generally not instinct. It's probably going off precedent, even if we're not aware of it. But we have to be wary of the tyranny of precedent in involving our decisions, because we all know out there right now, we are in a time that none of us have ever lived through before, circumstances we've never lived through before. And there are so many other things that are happening in our world where, you know, if we talk about a VUCA world and the world is changing, I would also say the delta of change is increasing. So in other words, change is changing faster than ever. So that means our ability to make good decisions is really important. And less will our past give us an indication of what decisions to make in the future. Particularly when we are in, and I know this is an overused term, but it's accurate, unprecedented times such as today. Well, also we have to be aware of is patterns that aren't really there. As human beings, our brains are lazy because they consume a lot of energy. So they only want to focus their energy on things that really matter. So if your brain can detect a pattern, it then shortcuts to a decision, right? It says, okay, oh, that's the situation. So we then make a decision. The problem is sometimes your brain thinks it's found a pattern that isn't really there. And so again, we might be making a suboptimal decision. In some cases, therefore, some data science tools can be useful in order helping us objectively to determine what option to select among many. However, be aware of GIGO, G-I-G-O, right? Garbage in, garbage out. A data tool is only as helpful and as accurate as the information you're entering into it. So how many data points are there? Is that enough to make that a useful, accurate tool? Over how much time? How many variables? How accurate are those variables? So, you know, for example, I'm not going to talk a lot really about decision trees today, but you all know what a decision tree is, I'm sure. I once was having a conversation with someone who really loved decision trees. Like, that's kind of how they made every decision. But we were talking about a human resources decision, about an individual, and they were trying to create what was the NPV, the net present value of decision related to this individual, letting them go, developing them, you know, retaining them, engage, et cetera. And he was putting probabilities on that, which is what you have to do, right? When you make a decision, what's the probability of this? Well, you don't know what the probability is, right? You're just making that up. You're just putting your finger in the air and saying, so of course, you know, that decision tree looked like it was very rigorously done, very accurate, right? So the NPV says, this is the decision we can make. Yeah, but it's based on complete garbage about the variables that you put in, the inputs that you put in to that decision tree. So also in terms of make sure you're using the tools properly, my advice when I talk to clients is I think these are some useful tools for you to use. And I'll even talk with them about what inputs to use, how many over how much time. But I don't administer the tool. because again, I'm not a data scientist. So when we get to that, have an expert use it. And most of our organizations have them. And if we don't, there are a lot of organizations out there now that will do that for you for a small fee. Let me just talk about some of those tools then. I'm just going to share three of my favorites, and then I'm going to return to Human Dynamics, because I think these are really useful ones for us to know are available to us, publicly available, often free or inexpensive. Monte Carlo simulations. Why do I like these? Well, it's a computerized mathematical technique that allows us to account for risk in quantitative analysis and decision making. So you can see how this is useful in portfolio management, asset management, you know, options pricing, energy, manufacturing, engineering, oil and gas, transportation, environment, you name it. Why is it called a Monte Carlo simulation? Well, because it's based on uncertainty and variability and risk. So just like the town Monte Carlo in Monaco, right, with all the casinos, it sort of is based on that principle. So Monte Carlo simulation furnishes the decision maker with a range of possible outcomes and probabilities. And it shows us the extreme possibilities, the outcomes if we go broke or making the most conservative decision, with all the possible consequences for even middle of the road decisions. So, you know, when I learned this in business school, the phrase that we often used about when this would be useful is if what you want to tell your boss is, I am 95% confident that the outcome of the decision will be between X and Y. Now, I'm not going to get into the math. I wasn't a math major, but a Monte Carlo simulation does many hundreds or thousands or tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of simulations. In other words, it runs a scenario many times. And then it gives you a shape, and here are all those, many of the possible shapes you could achieve. I think for amateurs like me and like many of you, the shape is what's very useful, right? Because that tells you something about what will be your likely scenario. So for example, if you look at a normal bell curve, like what we have in the second row on the left in this graph I'm giving you, there we have, you know, your classic bell curve. So that tells us, you know, that values kind of in the middle of the range are most likely to occur, right? That it's unlikely you'll have an extreme result on either end, whether that's positive or negative. On the other hand, a log normal result, like what you have in the upper right-hand corner, shows, for example, a positive or negative skew. In other words, it's more likely that we will have a very negative outcome or a very positive outcome. That's really helpful to know, right? Just that conclusion. Or you might have a uniform example, like in the lower right-hand corner, which says, well, all values have an equal chance of occurring, right? So that tells you something, too, which is helpful in terms of making. It might not exactly tell you what decision to make, but it starts to inform you of the consequences of the decision. Let's say, for example, I was an asset manager, right? And I wanted to know if I created a portfolio, an investment portfolio across a number of asset classes, and I defined what percent of capital to put in each asset class, you know, what is my value at risk? So how much maximum would I lose in any given year? For might be a question I want to ask myself. Well, let's say I run a Monte Carlo simulation. So it runs the scenario 100 times, and maybe only five times do I see a negative outcome that's 15% loss or less. Okay, so that tells me there's a 95% chance that the most I could possibly lose is 15% of my investment. That's helpful. Now, again, GIGO, right? Garbage in, garbage out. Is running it 100 times enough? It's a question, right, to ask. So that's really the role, I think, as leaders. Not necessarily to know how to run the tool precisely, but what assumptions to question, what questions to ask, what variables to ask for. Here's another tool that's really helpful, linear regression. So, right, visually, this just tells us how correlated is one factor to another. This is on Excel. You may not see it because, unfortunately, there are a lot of functions in Excel which are hidden, but you can bring them up, right? So it's part of the package, but you just have to search for it and add it to your toolbar. Excel is so much more useful than it looks at face value. So here, for example, this is telling us, is the number of hours of sleep I get per night correlated to my grumpiness? Well, you can see that if the each dot is an occurrence, like, so my level of grumpiness after a single night, every dot is like a morning, you see there's a very clear pattern, right? That line is just showing us where the pattern is. So if I see a pattern, then I know that there's a correlation. If those dots were all over the place and there was no pattern, then I know, okay, my grumpiness is not correlated to the amount of sleep that I have. That's really useful. So that's available to you, and it's free, and it's relatively easy to do. Whereas Monte Carlo simulation, on the other hand, that you'd have to add a package to Excel, which is the most common one is called At Risk. And again, cost a bit of money, and leave that one to the experts. This one you can do, it's free, and you can do it more yourself. Last tool I want to share with you before we get back into the human dynamic is Pareto analysis. So this is great for focusing our effort and our resources and our time, right? So this is based on the Pareto principle, which you may know as the 80-20 rule. It's named after an Italian economist and engineer who lived in the 19th century called Vilfredo Pareto. And it's why is his name associated with the 80-20 rule? Well, as an economist, he deduced that 80% of the income in Italy went to 20% of the population at that time. Now, just a quick side note, a footnote, a rant, if you will. Today, unfortunately, 50% of the world's wealth belongs to the top 1% of the population. I'll leave that to you as to whether that's correlated to social or unrest or political unrest. Let's put that aside for now, but we're going in an interesting direction, aren't we? But if you want to ask yourself, well, what thing should I focus my time on, for example, to solve a problem? This sample diagram on your screen shows us, like, for example, if I have a website and I want to know where should I be focusing the time for my website engineers to reduce the number of customer complaints, this is telling me, well, 80% of the complaints are down to three things: broken links, spelling errors, and missing title tags. Okay, so yeah, we could spend our time on a dozen different things, but really, software engineers, I'd like you to spend the vast majority of your time on these three things. Fix these three things, and we eliminate 80% of problems or complaints. That's really helpful, right? Because we all have unlimited number of resources, be that time, be that number of people, and however you quantify effort. Okay. I just wanted to share with you, because there are all kinds of tools out there, right? And they're all used for different purposes. So great question to ask is, well, what tools should I use based on what I want to find out? What I just wanted to do in this webinar is share with you my three favorite decision science tools. But before you get into tools, either in making a decision or consulting internally with your organization on decision making, what you first want to do is think about the dynamics at play here. So I want to now get into biases. One of the most common is the common information effect, right? Which basically means that a given team making a decision typically doesn't have all the right information at their disposal. And so the groups tend to overweight information that is commonly held, right? So because they all have the same assumptions, the same basis of knowledge, they quickly converge on answers because they think that represents the state of their world today, whereas they might be very siloed. And so commonly held information, of course, dominates the discussion. And so new factors, the delta of change increasing, right, is not affecting people's decisions, which it should. And of course, the other problem is our brains are lazy, right? So because we have shared information, we go, okay, well, we all know this to be true. So we make the decision because time works against us, right? We generally don't give ourselves enough time to make big decisions. So we rely on commonly held information and past information. This is a big issue, right? This, for example, was a big reason why the US had the Bay of Pigs disaster under the Kennedy administration, because a small team making the decision was using commonly held information. They weren't going outside their group to really test the assumptions implicit in their decision making. If any of you are poker players, you are very well aware of this bias, the escalation of commitment, right? So you don't have to know the rules of poker, but I'm sure you find this to be true if I just explain to you, right? If you're playing a game of poker, you generally, just to play, for the right to play, you got to put some chips on the table, right? That allows you to get some cards to then enter the game. So already you've put value at risk. Now, if then someone raises, even if it's a modest raise, so you put another chip on the table, someone else puts a modest rate, you put a chip on the table, and then you're deciding whether to fold or not. Unfortunately, many people don't think about what are the odds of they're having the winning hand at the table. What they're thinking is, oh, before I know it, I've now put three chips on the table. I don't want to lose three chips. So, and someone else raises again. Ah, now they raised me 10 chips. Well, I don't want to lose the three chips, so I got to put in the 10 chips. And now all of a sudden they're risking 13 chips, and they haven't considered whether they actually, what are their odds of winning? It's a really important dynamic to remember in any decision. Our fear of loss is typically greater than our desire for gain. So that fear of loss will typically overweigh our view of how much do I have to gain. And so we tend to throw good money after bad. So one of the most important pieces of advice that I share with clients is recognize what costs are sunk. In other words, an investment you made that you can't get it back. And then you have to sort of discard that in terms of any future decision you make, particularly related to additional resources you put in. Don't consider what you've already used up, because that's just gone, right? But if you think about, oh, I don't want that to go to waste, you can make a suboptimal decision. So set a good thing to do, and the great poker players do this, or if you're, say, in a negotiation about buying a car, buying a house, renting a house, set your limits up front, right? What is the maximum price or value that you are willing to put up or risk or offer? And know that ahead of time. What's also really important to avoid escalation of commitment is know what your alternatives are. In other words, if I can't make a deal, if I can't make this decision, yes, no, what other options are available to me? Because you have to know what your backup plan or plans are. Otherwise, you become more invested in forcing a decision that maybe is not going to be a good decision. Okay, some other biases to consider. Well, the conformity and obedience bias. This is related to the 55% of you who said too many decisions are pushed up the chain of command. So not only are many decisions made by a small number of people in the executive suite, but also, and I'm sure you've all seen this, many people defer too quickly to the leader of a team, the leader of a company, whatever that might be, right? And so you don't have disagreement. So who is your devil's advocate? That's a really important dynamic to include when making important decisions. Who nominate someone whose job it is to poke holes in our reasoning, in our assumptions, etc. Otherwise, you'll find that in too many cases, people defer to the leader. Anchor bias. Be careful about the first figures that you propose. So let's say, for example, you're at a fair. And you know, you see they have that contest where guess how many jelly beans are in the jar, right? Well, if you see someone come up and they say, and they write down on their guess, I think there are 1,000 jelly beans in the jar. Whether you know it or not, if you then write down a guess, you're anchoring your guess off of 1,000. In other words, you're saying, well, do I think it's more or less than 1,000? The problem is, of course, you have no idea whether that person's guess was at all accurate. The figure 1,000 could be way off. And yet now what we're saying is, you know, well, is it 1,100 or is it 900? Whereas actually there may be 20,000 beans in the jar. So of course, in that scenario, a better thing to do, if you can, is look over the shoulder of, you know, dozens or hundreds of people that are writing down guesses before you enter a guess and take the average. In that particular scenario, you'll be much more likely to get the right answer. So beware anchor bias. Okay, likeness bias. Generally, you know, we tend to overweigh the assessments of people who are like us, whether it's socioeconomically, whether because they're our friends, because we have a similar background, etc. So be wary of that. This is also why it's so important to have neurodiversity in teams, why it's important to think about whether you have the correct and diverse composition within a team before you make that team make a decision. Proximity bias. So right now we're all working from home, but if you think about your office, how many of your decisions are influenced by the people directly around you? Or in another case, just by the people in your team, even in our working remotely environment, versus the whole organization, or your customers, or your suppliers, or your regulators. how often do you bring in their view? If you don't, then you're probably guilty of the proximity bias. I talked about the precedent bias. We overweigh the results of past decisions in making current decisions. If our environment is particularly volatile, then precedent is less and less an indicator of what the future will hold. Okay, this is a great quotation, you know, and it just shows how the wonderful Alfred Sloan, the former CEO of General Motors, said, "I take it we're all in complete agreement on the decision here. Then I propose we postpone further discussion of this matter until our next meeting to give ourselves time to develop disagreement and perhaps gain some understanding of what this decision is all about." Speaking of encouraging disagreement and looking outside, this is really kind of the nub of what I'm talking about. Be careful of converging on a decision too quickly and question the assumptions implicit on the decisions that you're making. Because it's difficult to make decisions about the future, right? Because we can't see it. And so we have to embrace the principle of openness, and that requires eliminating a baked-in set of assumptions about where ideas come from and how best to exploit them. This is otherwise known as the classic and toxic cocktail of NIH, not invented here, right? Unless it comes from the top, unless it comes from inside the company, unless it comes from my team, I reject the alternative. Or controlism, right? In the conventional decision-making model, we invent, commit to, and develop decisions all on our own. And that's a problem, right? As managers, we tend to shut down, we tend to converge, we tend to create limits instead of expanding and diverging. If you look in a thesaurus, in almost any language on the planet, look up the word manage, to manage, the verb. Probably the first synonym you will find is to control, right? And that tells you everything you need to know about how we assume the practice of management is supposed to happen, based on the precepts of the Industrial Revolution. And of course, is that still valid today? So just to bring us to a seven-step approach that I often suggest for clients who are making a big decision is, first, create a constructive environment for that decision. And that has to do with mitigating the biases that I've listed. Then really investigate the decision, the situation in detail, right? Gather your information carefully. Look at the accuracy of that information. Do you have enough information? Generate alternatives. Don't, you know, force yourself into a binary decision, and certainly not too quickly. And think about what's your alternative if none of our options in this decision are going to be the best one, or if it all falls apart. Then how you select the best decision is really important. Who do you bring into the conversation? How do you make sure the conversation isn't dominated by a few voices? How do you make sure that people aren't simply, you know, agreeing with the boss? And then look at your implementation plan really carefully, right? A lot of decisions fail, not because it wasn't the right decision, but because it was implemented poorly. So implementation is as important as making the decision. How we communicate the decision is related to the point about how we implement the decision. How do you bring people on board, right? Your influence, your engagement is really important, particularly if this decision affects everyone and you're asking people to change habits, to practice a new process, et cetera. And then monitor the results, right? Again, you don't want to be overly invested in your decision. If data is telling you over time it was the wrong decision, then you have to let it go. You have to question it. You have to reevaluate it. So look, this list is not about earth-shattering insight. The point is, most organizations, most managers, leaders, teams don't follow these steps. They shortcut one, some, or most of them. So we discussed biases and things to be aware of and to avoid. We talked about, you know, maybe a process to follow so that we don't shortcut to get to a suboptimal decision. Now let's talk about other things to do, some great habits to start to practice, to either create more options, to evaluate more options, to bring the outside in. One great habit, and this is particularly topical today, is in virtual teams. Virtual teams are actually really good about eliminating some of the biases that I've discussed. So when you have an asynchronous, anonymous, virtual brainstorming session, all of those biases around, you know, people deferring to the most senior person in the room, the most extroverted person in the room, or whatever it is, anywhere where voices dominate because of gender, nationality, culture, seniority, you name it, those things become disintermediated if we can do that in an asynchronous virtual, for example, discussion board. Then it becomes a meritocracy of ideas. I find this really, really helpful when you're at that divergent brainstorming stage. Then how you analyze the options are very important, right? How you make sure, and again, virtual, asynchronous, anonymous brainstorm platform can help you with this. And then bring in the experts at the right time, right? So there's always a spectrum between crowdsourcing a decision and bringing in like a single expert to just tell us what to do. Well, often the answer is you need both. So bring in the expert at the right time, probably not at the very beginning, right? Because if you bring in like a world-class expert and they say, do this, then of course, everyone will just say, all right, well then the expert has told us what to do, let's just do that. That may or may not be the right thing to do. So think about, how does your culture help and hinder great decision-making and decision implementation? The wonderful authors and scholars, Rob Goffey and Gareth Jones, talked about the advantages and disadvantages, particularly to having cultures of sociability or solidarity. What do I mean by that? Well, if you have a culture of sociability, people want to get along, you have great friends at work, people socialize a lot at work. What that also means, I'm sure you're seeing where I'm going with this, is that decisions often take longer to implement because everyone wants to be involved, everyone wants to be part of the decision, everyone wants lots of meetings where you can get together and discuss before they get on board. Now, that isn't always a bad thing, but that is a trade-off when you have a highly sociable culture. Or you have a culture of high solidarity where everyone is just, okay, tell me what to do and then I will do it. And I know I'm going to be evaluated based on that. It's going to become one of my KPIs. And the better I deliver and the faster I deliver, that's what I'm about, right? So we all quickly get in line, get information and start marching. Now that can be good or bad, right? There are trade-offs. So an example of that, and Rob and Gareth talk about this in one of their books, the British confectioner or the US confectioner Mars, right, they wanted to get into the ice cream business years ago. They, you know, obviously they create Mars candy bars and things like that. Well, they wanted to be the leader in the UK for ice cream. Well, at that time, the number one leader in UK ice cream was Walls. I'm sure you all are aware of Walls ice cream. And so Mars said, this is the decision we're making. So everyone got in line and they all started marching forward. And, you know, now we're going to do that. We're going to become number one in ice cream. Unfortunately, because they were all marching in formation as quickly as possible, no one was seeing the folly of that decision, that they were, you know, throwing good money after bad, that they weren't dominating the market in the manner they had hoped or in the time they had hoped. And so after a while, you know, no one was telling all the lemmings, we're going to march right off the cliff. So that could be a disadvantage of solidarity, right? Everyone marches right off the cliff because no one questions the decision. So you have to think about where you want to be on that spectrum in your culture of sociability and solidarity. It's a good thing to evaluate where your culture is now and then, you know, act accordingly in terms of implementing the decision. Don't forget engagement for big decisions before you get into implementation. Okay, let's talk a bit more about crowdsourcing. Sometimes companies create contests to open up their perspectives. Today, you can't turn around in a marketing department or sit in on an industry conference or flip a page in a business magazine without bumping into an innovation contest. You know what? This is funny. The term crowdsourcing didn't even exist until it was first written in Wired magazine in 2003. But the earliest efforts to tap into the wisdom of the crowd dates back at least to 1714, when the British Parliament proposed a £20,000 prize for the discovery of a method of accurately measuring a ship's longitude. So much of that prize went to John Harrison's pioneering marine chronometer. And later that century, Napoleon offered a 12,000 franc prize to drive innovation in food preservation. You can imagine he was thinking it's important for my armies to be well fed in the field. Well, that spurred a French brewer and confectioner named Nicolas Appert to develop canning. Unfortunately, his first cans were made of lead. That created its own issues, but you know, they perfected the process over time. And more recently, a variety of organizations have embraced crowdsourced competitions and their efforts to find solutions to challenges, whether that's diverse as providing space travel for tourists, the inaugural X Prize, improving Netflix's recommendation algorithm, finding a cure for brain cancer, and analyzing the some 30 petabytes of data collected annually from the Large Hadron Collider. So let's talk about just this virtue of crowdsourcing. I'm sure many of you, if not all of you, are familiar with the classic game show, Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? If you saw the fabulous film Slumdog Millionaire, you know this game show, right? So a contestant has 15 questions to get up to $1 million bucks or £1 million pounds or whatever. And every question gets harder. If they get a question wrong, they're done. And they will frequently lose all or most of the money that they had earned up to that point. Very high risk game. Really hard, right, to earn $1 million. If you think about it, you have to get 15 general trivia questions right in a row, and you get one wrong, you're out, and the questions get harder. Oh my God. Well, how do they help you? Well, the game show organizer said you have three lifelines. Ask the audience 50-50 and phone a friend. Ask the audience is simple. You ask the audience, right? They enter which of the four options, it's always multiple choice, which of the four answers do they think is right? And you see what percent of the audience guessed each of the four alternatives. Or 50-50, so the computer eliminates two of the wrong answers, and then you have a 50-50 chance of getting it right. Or you can phone a friend. So you literally call, talk to a friend what they think the answer is, and then you select your answer. Okay, I wanna ask you, here's a poll. Loic, can we bring up a poll? If you go to your right, what do you think, if you were playing Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, so you are now in the hot seat, which lifeline would you value most? Ask the audience, 50-50, or phone a friend. Which one would you think, that's the one I need for my trickiest question, or that's the one I'm gonna hold on to and not use until, you know, until the end, until it's desperation time. Okay, this is really interesting. So at the moment, okay, it's changed dramatically now, right? As more people are entering. Because for a minute there, two-thirds of you were saying phone a friend, and a third of you were saying 50-50, and no one was saying ask the audience. So now it's, okay, it's now an even distribution, ladies and gentlemen. It's still changing a bit, but it's roughly a third, a third, a third. That's really interesting. Okay, it's reduced now a little bit. So definitely for us, great. For us as an this group, 23% of you, the least popular answer is ask the audience. The most popular is phone a friend. Well, you know what? That's the same for the actual contestants on Who Wants to Be a Millionaire. They least value ask the audience. They most value phone a friend. But let's look at what the error is in terms of, if you look at all the history of Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, when a contestant chooses each of those lifelines, what is the error probability? In other words, once they chose that lifeline, how often did they then get the question wrong? Okay, so when people did phone a friend, they were then wrong 46% of the time. But if you think about it, why is that? Well, again, think about the biases I talked about, likeness bias, proximity bias. We overweight the opinion of a single individual because we like them, because we know them. But that's only one brain. Right? You've only doubled the mental capacity attacking the problem. For those who went to 50-50, they only got the question wrong about 16% of the time. And for people who did ask the audience, they only got the question wrong 6% of the time, because you have a huge mass of brains tackling the problem. Now, they're not exactly telling you what the question is, but you see where the majority is landing. Only 6% of the time you get the question wrong. That's amazing. There are actually data scientists who have done peer-reviewed papers out there, often mathematicians, and they said they were trying to figure out what is the best way to use your lifelines to win Who Wants to Be a Millionaire. What they determined is, this is kind of funny, they said you should use, based on all the statistical analysis, you should use phone a friend at question 11, and you should use ask the audience at question 14. In other words, they're saying mathematically, ask the audience is your dearest lifeline. It will yield the most, you will maximize the probability that you'll get the answer right. So you should save it till the penultimate question. So why am I sharing all this about Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? It's demonstrating mathematically the power of crowdsourcing. But let's talk more broadly about open innovation. Because when we're talking about decision-making related to brainstorming, things like what new product should we create, or what new product should we adapt, or what service should we adapt or create, that's a big decision. That's a strategic decision. What distribution process should we follow? What operational model should we follow? So let's talk about this. This is a question that Lego was asking itself more than 15 years ago out of desperation. What new products should we really be inventing. Because in 2003, this legendary brand was on the verge of bankruptcy. Many internally thought its classic brightly colored building blocks were becoming irrelevant to kids weaned on video games and digital devices. For decades, Lego has been one of the world's most insular, vertically integrated, and publicity-shy organizations. But today, it is the Apple of toys, a highly designed profit machine with an obsessive fan base. And to a large extent, that turnaround was due to, at the time, their new CEO, Jørgen Vig Nudstorp, who, when he joined in 2004, was an energetic 36-year-old father of four, the first outsider to lead Lego in its 80-year history. After he shored up the company's finances, he engaged the organization in two core priorities. One, deepening understanding of how kids around the world play. Two, look outside. So invite university researchers and faithful fans to help us invent the future of Lego product development. So in a very real sense, it was Lego's fans and unlikely ones at that, that woke the company up to the power of opening up their decision-making to outside the organization itself. Lego first went outside in 1998 when it partnered with MIT's famed Media Lab to develop a digital physical hybrid, which they called Mindstorms. So that was a software app which combined with a microcontroller brick. Basically, this was a kit for building robots. And to the company's great surprise and chagrin at the time, they learned that 70% of Mindstorms users were not 5 to 11-year-old boys, Lego's core customers. They were adults. And to add insult to injury, Mindstorms was quickly and thoroughly hacked by users eager to share their builds on the internet. So Lego's management's first reaction was calling the lawyers. All those hackers have no right to screw with our IP. The Mindstorms team, on the other hand, saw the hacking as a sign of the product's success. Luckily, they prevailed. And instead of sanctioning the hackers, Lego added a right to hack clause to the Mindstorms software license. And they created a website and a discussion forum for Mindstorms enthusiasts. The results? A robust Mindstorms ecosystem with dedicated websites for sharing what they called MOCs, M-O-C's, My Own Creations. Hundreds of pages of user-generated documentation, umpteen how-to books, startup companies selling third-party sensors and hardware, a series of competitions for master builders. Mindstorms went on to become the best-selling product in the company's history. And then it was left to wither on the vine as Lego faced financial challenges. That is until 2004, when Nudstorp set his sights on reviving it as Mindstorms NXT. This time they vowed they'd go further still when it came to involving citizen innovators. How they would make decisions in terms of new products is they brought in super users, super fans, into their inner sanctum to play with the product, to play with variables of the product, to create new elements of the product, new features. The expectation was that these contributors would contribute how and when they liked, to whatever degree worked for them. They asked for applications for 100 places. They received 10,000 applications. By the way, these were uncompensated roles, right? So this is just asking the fan base to get involved. The result? In its first year, Mindstorms NXT generated $30 million of revenue and brought a new generation of passionate builders into Lego's innovation ecosystem. A really great way to make an important decision about the future of Lego's product development. So what I'm saying is the goal here is to dramatically enlarge the aperture between your perspective and that of the outside world. Here's why that's important. Over time, a smaller and smaller proportion of a company's employees have customer-facing roles. Isn't that kind of ironic? As a company gets bigger, a smaller and smaller percent of that company are customer-facing. Most employees face inward. They manage internal relationships with other units, corporate staff functions, or supply chain partners. And yet we live in a world where customers wake up every day and they're asking themselves, what's new? What's amazing? What have you done for me lately? And just as with Lego super users, a lot of those customers know things you don't. So how do you open yourselves to that wider marketplace for ideas? How do you make sure in your decision-making you are bringing in the voice of the customer, or at least a good facsimile thereof? Now, we talked about time, another great habit. Sorry, I put crowdsourcing here. I mean, create time. Is it? So create a FedEx day for yourself. What do I mean by a FedEx day? Nothing to do with FedEx per se, but based on the FedEx promise that you'll have it delivered the next day. So this principle comes from the idea of 3M, Google, WL Gore, who give a lot of their people one day a week to work on something that's interesting to them. If you have an important decision, consider making it a whole day or a series of days over a month versus like a 1 hour committee meeting. Now, I know you're under enormous pressure, but how can we test a decision over the course of a day, over 24 hours? But it does have to happen overnight. So, you know, you're basically running a hackathon, a decision-making hackathon, where people are proposing ideas, you're evaluating the ideas, discussing, challenging, developing, maybe pitching ideas to get peer feedback. But this whole thing is 24 hours, literally overnight. Some amazing ideas may emerge. Some may be just very, very practical, but I think you can make quick progress. Now, you don't have to go the Google model and do one day a month related to making your biggest decisions or hacking or whatever, but maybe it's a few days a year. But surely it's got to be something where you can't say, well, we never have time. You never have time to make some of the most important strategic decisions in the company or some of the most important decisions in your team. Well, then I would say you're not using your time valuably or in the right way. You're not prioritizing properly. But I tell you, most of us don't think about running hackathons, 24-hour FedEx days to make big decisions. What we generally do is we get people together in a committee, we make a decision, and then we fret about it, and then we fail in implementing it, you know, 90% of the time. I just don't think that's the way we should think about this, right? Okay, so let me ask you, based on, we talked about a lot, we've covered a lot in a very short amount of time. So if we can go to the next poll, please. We've talked about great habits, virtuous habits in making better decisions. And by the way, if you think there's a lot of overlap and crossover with innovation, you're right. You know, I think, you know, great decision makers who create a great process for opening up innovation, removing biases and assumptions, also tend to become better innovators because all those great habits help both things, decision making and innovating. So if there's any reason why you should spend more time and effort being a better decision maker, there's another, you know, tangential benefit. I think you become a more creative business practitioner. So which one maybe resonated most with you? Just getting a quick feedback in terms, because you're all practitioners in the field out there. Based on what we've talked about, would you want to? So look at your options on the far right, blending instinct and data better, right? Not just relying on instinct. And also being careful about data, right? Who's running the data tool? Are we questioning the inputs in those decision science tools? Maybe I should do some more asynchronous anonymous brainstorming, easier to do since most of us are working from home. Should I do more crowdsourcing, right? Increase the aperture of my view to the outside world? Should I bring the outside in? Or should I make more time? Well, it's a pretty even distribution. Well, I'm pleased with that, actually, right? I mean, obviously, I chose these habits because I thought, well, all of them are useful and all of them may speak to different people in their different contexts. So I'm pleased that that is telling me for most of you, all of these were helpful, or at least this was kind of equally helpful or broadly helpful to all of you, no matter where you're joining us and what your context is. Look, what I would say is the most important thing is that we need to feel more confident in a volatile world. That means that we probably have to increase the frequency of our decision making, look back at past decisions, and make more involve more people in our decision making process, because we know that any decision is going to be worthy of reevaluating and possibly adapting a year down the line, 5 years down the line. But also things will occur to us. The tsunami of change and contexts, the tides of change will wash over us with more frequency than ever. So our ability to respond and make good decisions to that change make us better leaders and help our organizations to be more relevant today than to slowly crawl toward being extinct. Great, let's pause and let's bring Loic back into this and let's look at, you may have questions or reflections. If you do, could I ask if you could just pop those in, type those into the questions box, which for most of you will probably be on the right-hand side of your screen. If you open that tab by clicking on that downward arrow under questions.
So we did actually have a few questions come in.
Fab.
So please do continue to send them in. We'll try to answer them during this Q&A session. So the first one I have here is, company structure, we have flat structure, we have horizontal structure. What is the best structure for decision-making on the long term?
Well, I'm going to give you a frustrating answer, but it's true. It depends. It depends on the nature of the decision, right? Certainly, I think, for example, when it comes, the best, like for, I was talking about product or service development, which is often one of the most important decisions we can make. Far too often, in my experience, when I work with clients on this, over 90% of the time when they first tell me about how they make that decision, they don't involve their customers or clients. That's ridiculous, right? So a structure would be to involve those some of those parties, right? Involve some of your most trusted, most influential customers and clients into such a decision. But actually, it's a good thing. You mentioned it implicit in your question is that in your context, you have a very flat organizational structure. That's good, right? That probably means architecturally, you are less likely to fall under the bias of conformity and obedience to seniority, to the boss, right? Because you just simply don't have as many layers in the organization. I mean, it reminds me, I was involved in an important decision in a management team that I used to belong to. And we brought in someone from the analytics team, right, to help us make the decision. So here, this was our decision scientist, our in-house decision scientist. And, you know, this poor guy was, it was a fairly hierarchical group. I mean, there are about 7 layers in total in the company, right? So we were all at layers 1 or 2. This poor guy was at layer like 5 or 6. And he came in, you know, and as he was talking through our options, his hands were shaking, you know? And I'm thinking to myself, A, I really feel for you. And I was trying my best to make him feel comfortable. But also I'm thinking, he's not going to challenge us. He's not going to question our assumptions. Right. So part of that is, did we also, in addition to do we have too many layers, did we create the right environment culturally where that person knew he could walk into that room and not get shot down for challenging us? Right. Which that tells us there's a lot of work. There's a lot of kind of setting the ground, fertilizing the ground that leaders have to do before you create the dynamic of actually an important decision in, say, a strategy committee meeting. That's a long-winded answer because there are a lot of different things that you may have to look at.
So was he able to actually kind of like say from the data?
Well, I did my best. I mean, I asked him explicitly some of those kinds of questions like, you know, what are we missing here, right? What are we not talking about that we should be? What tools should we be incorporating that we haven't? You know, what have you heard where you think maybe there's an assumption? But, you know, you could just see the gears turning in his head, like, ah, if I say anything, am I putting my job at risk? And, you know, I felt horrible. And, you know, that's not just, it was on us as a committee, you know, that was a cultural result. That's on all of us. And that was on me, that I had not created an environment where he could walk in with complete comfort to know that his job was to help us make the best decision possible collectively, rather than my job is to get in there and not get killed. Unfortunately.
No, that's a really interesting point. So thank you, Adam, for that. So I have another question here is, what is the single most important thing that a leader needs to consider before making an important decision?
Yeah, well, I think it's that, right? Because I think far too often companies make suboptimal decisions and leaders make suboptimal decisions because they haven't created the environment. Then I gave you a 7-step process, right? So once you have, and number one is that environment piece, then follow a process, right? Again, generally when we make decisions, we just kind of do willy-nilly, like, oh, we'll get a few people together, we'll chat it through, and we'll make a decision. We didn't follow a process. We didn't evaluate the criteria we were using. We didn't look at our inputs to then just determine the accuracy of our outputs. We didn't look at how we were going to implement the decision. We didn't just determine how we were going to evaluate the decision once it was being implemented. So we have to be simple. In the short answer to your question is you have to be more rigorous. Look at your environment and create a process. Now, just because in the process that I suggested has seven steps does not mean necessarily that it will take forever to do that. I'm not saying that, you know, that will take forever. Once that becomes a habit, like all good habits, it speeds up, it accelerates. It might feel hard and kind of like a long military campaign at first, but when it becomes reflexive, when it becomes habitual, when you say we have to come together to make a decision and everyone around you knows what that means in terms of the process, the questions you're going to ask, the process you're going to go through, it will get easier. It will get faster. If for no other reason, as you habitualize it, everyone knows the process, you won't have to teach them the process, right? At the same time that you're doing the process, you simply do it. And you can, and once you can make great decision-making reflexive, an autonomic part of organizational life, then decision-making is not just more rigorous, it's faster and easier. Just like when you get on the treadmill, for example, right, and you start jogging, you know your heart rate's going to go up. You don't have to do anything. You don't have to go, come on, heart, now is the time for you to speak. It's reflexive. Well, that's kind of what has to happen in your organization when you say, we have to make an important decision. The body, the organism, simply snaps into an action because they know what is required.
No, great. Thank you very much, Adam. And I mean, the next question, so you do actually work with quite a lot of clients. So the question is, how could this content be integrated as part of a wider leadership development program?
Very easily, actually. And it really is a good thing to do. You know, I think any program that involves strategy composition and or strategy implementation, this should be incorporated into that type of program. I would also say any program that involves marketing, either marketing strategy, marketing implementation, or as I said, product or service innovation, creativity, adaptation, you should use this. Anything involving innovation, this is a helpful process, right? Because innovation, how do we do innovation? It's just kind of willy-nilly and we throw, you know, silly putty up against the wall and then we pick the brightest color. How do we do innovation? Well, that's related to decision making. And again, the decision making process, when you make it more rigorous, you break down innovation. When and how are we at the brainstorming stage? When and how are we at the evaluation stage? When and how are we at the selection stage? When and how are we at the implementation stage of innovation? Very similar to decision making. But don't conflate those four steps in the innovation lifeline, right? Each one is an important decision to take. So that's also a really useful way. Really what we're doing, why decision making can be implemented so easily across a number of different development programs in executive education, is this decision making, if you think about the way I've discussed it and contextualized it, it's like a skeleton, right? So then the muscle and the skin that you put on top of the skeleton could be strategy or marketing or innovation, but you have a skeleton, which is the way in which, the architecture in which you're going to tackle that problem, whether it's strategy or marketing or innovation, etc.
No, great. That's really, really helpful. Thank you. I'm conscious of time, so maybe we can have one last question. I think it's okay. More for a recommendation. So do you know any assessment tool for decision-making styles?
Like, oh, well, a tool to then select what decision
exactly
to use. Oh, God.
Or
I'm
is there any other way to actually know your decision-making?
I think I don't know about a tool like a scientific tool to say if X then Y, use this tool, but I think maybe actually what you're asking is to test how my decision making preferences, so the human side of it, right?
Exactly.
So just like okay, well, I'm sure they exist. You know, I haven't I can't think of one. So this is my cheat answer. I can't think of an explicit one, but I think they're out there, like an assessment type tool. If there isn't one, I think one can be easily created. And I think, as always with these things, it's helpful to customize it, right? To work on a client-by-client basis on what are the strongest trends, biases, and perturbations in the organization. around how we make decisions and then create an assessment around that. And then that's particularly helpful when working around a leadership team, so you get a sense of the different styles in relation to making a decision. Just as, for example, when you're talking about more basic team dynamics, you might do a Belbin assessment to see what are the preferred team roles in a team. So I'm sorry, that doesn't answer completely, but certainly I'm saying yes, that could and would be helpful. And I'm sure there are things out there. My instinct would maybe be to customize those, something like that.
No, I think that actually is accurate and makes sense. Thank you very, very much, Adam, for that. So yeah, we're a bit behind time. Okay. Adam, I really want to thank you for this session. I found it really, really interesting. I mean, I hope the public as well found it interesting as much as I did. So thank you very much for joining this session, as always. I'd like to thank you, everybody who joined today. I hope you enjoyed this, and I hope you will come back for our next webinar shortly. Adam, everyone, have a really, really lovely day. Again, please be safe. Have a great day.
Thank you, everyone. Bye.